Good evening, I'd like to open the planning board meeting for the town of Deerfield, January 3rd, 2017, at 7 p.m. here in the town offices at 8 Conway Street. Let me just go over the agenda for this evening. We're going to review the minutes of the December 5th meeting. We'll look at some mail, we have public comment, and then we have three public hearings. One is a site plan review for 31 Elm Street, which involves Cumberland Farms. Second one is condominiums at Sugarloaf, the first look at a definitive plan. The third public hearing is a site plan review, it's a preliminary discussion about 4 Greenfield Roads. Then we'll look at any other business not reasonably anticipated in advance. We'll set a meeting, we'll set a date for the next meeting, and then we'll adjourn. Planning board members, have any else to add? I'd suggest we change the mail and put that later in the agenda, also we'll do that anyway. And I'd like to just make sure that we're all accounted for here, so we have 7 people on the planning board, and all 7 of us are here tonight. The 7 members, Kip is coming, John, Rachel, John, Kip, Paul, thanks for everybody being here. And thank you for, I'm assuming other people who are interested in some of the topics we're going to talk about have come out tonight, and I really appreciate that, especially given the miserable weather. So we've driven safely here, hopefully everybody gets home okay as well. This is being aired by our FCT.
FCU.
Are you recording?
And they're recording that.
You are. So.
I know, that's what I said.
She still said she wanted to be recording.
I don't see it turning on.
So we have the December 5th meeting. I'd like to do the review the minutes for the December 5th planning board meeting because they actually have things that we're going to talk about tonight, so it's probably important to make sure.
Okay.
We have a good, yes.
Thank you.
Did we skip public comment or there was none?
I think that's it.
Okay.
Public comment. Normally I offer someone who has something that's not on the agenda tonight but just wants to let us know about something that's important that the planning board should know about, this would be the time to just mention it, public comment. But if it's about something we're going to talk about tonight, I'd ask you to hold it till then. So seeing the public comment about other items, we'll move on to the public hearings. So the first one involves 31 Elm Street, Cumberland Farms. So I need to this is a continuation of the site plan review that we started back on December 5th. And is there anybody here representing Cumberland Farms? So I've been notified, actually, that they might not attend, and that's because we are waiting on the, this is also involved the Conservation Committee, and the main item left for their move from the center of town to the corner of Elm and 5 and 10 is stormwater issues, and they're still resolving that. So the CONCOM meets later this month, and I know the CONCOM is working on it, and they've been working with DEP. Part of it is about stormwater management, and also, if you remember, one of the big issues we had was the 2 feet of infiltration for water, and I believe the last I heard is that they are planning, their engineers are planning to raise the building a little bit, so there will be about 2 feet between the, with the construction on the top and the infiltration. So, seeing that that's on hold, I think we need to move to continue the public hearing until our next planning board meeting.
John, didn't the ZBA also continue their meeting? They're not finished with the Cumberland Farms issue, are they?
The last meeting, they said they were done.
Yeah, they were done.
No, they're not done. They're not done.
But they haven't, they closed the meeting, I think.
They continued.
They continued.
Oh, they did, okay.
They closed and continued, and that's, what, the 27th, is that? Sound about right? There was supposed to be one just before Christmas, wasn't there?
Right, it was going to be one in December, so I haven't, I did not hear about that. I have heard about the Concom, how they're going to have theirs. And we did get a report from Newman Environmental Engineering, who they've been back and forth with that. And I should also introduce Pat Smith from the Franklin Regional Council of Government, who was our peer review on some of these projects tonight. Was there some other information you have about the Cumberland's issue?
I think that there is the Mass DEP review just received. There was an email I saw from Mark Stinson in regard to the 2-foot, you know, the requirement that it would be above the seasonal large hill. So there has been some progress on that, and I did receive copies of revised plans so that I can now proceed with my review of the zoning compliance. And that was another thing that you guys need before you're going to be in a position to make a decision on the plan. So we will proceed with that review and get those materials out to you and the applicant in advance of that your next meeting so that there can be comments back and forth. And if there's anything that they need to do to respond, that can happen.
So we do have a hearing continuation request, and it's dated December 22nd, application to the planning board regarding site plan review and stormwater permit. The applicant, Cumberland Farms, they hereby request that a hearing be continued until January 3rd at 7 o'clock. So that was from the other one. They have indicated that they want to continue again, and that by their absence tonight, that we will do that, and we'll schedule it at the next planning board meeting. In the meantime, we did ask for comments from town officials, and I think we might as well make it clear that we do have a highway superintendent. Has no comments. They welcome a new building. The Concom, as I mentioned before, the Conservation Commission is still under peer review, so they don't have a comment yet. The police chief, their concern is the impact of additional traffic at the intersection of Greenfield Road and Elm Street, and Mass Department of Transportation will be looking at the traffic. That whole circulation, DOT actually has some jurisdiction over when Route 5 and 10 is a state road. And so if it extends anything, I think it's 150 feet, is that what we determined? 100 or 150 feet from that, they have some jurisdiction. So they're going to be working on that. So the police chief does know there will be impact at this intersection, and they want to hear more. So those are the comments from other town officials. So can we vote to continue this to our next meeting?
Mm-hmm. Make a motion to continue to our next scheduled meeting. Anyone have it?
One second.
Is that the first Monday in February?
Yes.
February 6th.
So the next planning board meeting, February 6th. I'll continue this one for that. Do we have a second?
I just did.
Okay. Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Abstained.
7-0.
So we'll move on to this notice of public hearing, the second one. And let me read this. This was published in our the newspaper twice. And sent out to the buyers probably, but let me read it, and then we'll make sure we have all the paperwork on this one. Notice of public hearing, the Deerfield Planning Board will hold a public hearing pursuant to the definitive plan submitted by Mark Whiteman of Futures Unlimited for a subdivision entitled The Condominiums at Sugarloaf, located off Sugarloaf Street, Assessors Map 174, parcels 61-64, that will consist of 35 new building lots for two-family homes. The hearing will be held on January 3rd, 2017, at 7 p.m. in the Deerfield Municipal Offices, City Conway Street. Copies of the plans are on file in the municipal offices and are available to the public for inspection. Any person interested or wishing to be heard should appear at this time and place designated. So that was properly published, and so if we could have the applicants for the condominiums at Sugarloaf is what we're going to refer to them as officially.
John, should we pass it around the sign-in sheet for everybody? I got this one here, but I mean the public.
Yeah, we need to come up with just right. So you have a easel?
I did.
Because we've got this camera set up, so it's the same as like last time over here. So I would ask that once we set up the easel, we want to make sure that this is also being recorded and available to people on the TV. So if you're blocking anybody, you might have to move some other people over. Pat, would you want to, can you come up? Sit with us. John, you want to grab it? Just to inform people, there's a third public hearing. We'll start after this one is complete. When we put out the public notice, we say 7 o'clock because we're not really sure. And I got to tell you, this is the first time in a while we've had three public hearings at once. So if you're here for that one, we don't really know when it's going to start. We're going to do a fairly thorough job on this one. So stay tuned. So just to let people know that we saw the preliminary site plan for these condominiums at Sugarloaf, and that was actually approved by the planning board
October 3rd.
On October 3rd, and that means that now the applicant can come forward with the definitive site plan review. Having gotten approval on the preliminary doesn't really mean anything as far as the definitive. The applicants still have to go through all the steps of our bylaws. Will we do everything again? They might have made changes. But it was appreciated that we do have a lot of background on this project, so we're glad we did that. But now we do start to come in. So
all of them.
So unless the planning board has anything else to add, we'll ask the applicants to make the presentation. So, Mark, take it away.
Sure. Hello, my name is Mark Whiteman. Is that loud?
Perfect.
Well, we're standing at Mexican here. I'm the applicant, and to my left is Tony Wonseski from SKE Engineering. This is Attorney James Graves, and...
Come in. Why then?
One of my soils people inside, Andy James, from GZA, and they're out of Connecticut. We feel tonight we're prepared to answer any questions the board has. We understand that this is pretty complex, well above my ability in math, the engineering, and a tremendous amount of data as well as survey information. So we were thinking that you'll probably want to start with figuring out who you want to use for a peer review group. Obviously, Pat is here for the dialogue, making sure that the definitive plan information in the book was followed. And then, of course, we need to make sure you're hiring someone who's going to review the data that Tony's company has done, SDE has done. And if you want to start there, it probably makes the most sense. I don't know how much we can review without having that review done. So we wanted to give you an overview of the project for people that weren't here for the preliminary plan. I'm telling you a little bit of an overview on that, and themselves as to who, I think Tony has some thoughts as well on peer review and who they've worked with in the past in Deerfield. And we're anticipating the next meeting will be where we get your guts at it, because we'll have peer review information back. So I just think it makes more sense to have you guys have as much information as possible before trying to go into in-depth in those piles of data. Does that make sense?
Yes, that sounds very good. So yeah, tonight I think a brief presentation, maybe highlight things that have changed over the past couple months might be good for us. But then that is that that comes back to us to discuss. We will, as you know, this is a complicated thing, so we want to hire the right people, and depending upon what might be the major subjects, you know, that might indicate who we should hire or not. I believe, is this a 90-day after they submit it? Is that the kind of the goal that we're going to try to do, is move through this quickly, in a timely manner, at the same time address every issue that we need to address. Just as during the preliminary plan, I know you guys are patient, and if we need to, if it took a little longer, and we all agree to, we can do that, but I think our goal is to keep it moving over the next.
On a personal note, I want to say that I've been very impressed with my engineering company. They've done a fantastic job. They've been dotting the I's and crossing the T's. Everybody here has been fantastic. Dan's worked very well with us on a daily basis. I hate to see that bill. Speaking of that, Dan, you go home now. And Danny did give up a Friday for me to do some additional stormwater management work, just to make sure we're verifying some data, and it's been very helpful. And Deb Henson actually came out also, his neighbor, took a look at the pole while we're out there as well. So we're trying to work as best we can through the process. I think that the people of Deerfield, a point was made to me a little while ago by somebody that I think a lot of the people don't understand the process and what they can, how the public does and does not have the ability to really have something to say about this in fashion. They all have something to say, but the real bottom line is the planning board is a board that was elected into town to be able to oversee things in this fashion. The bylaws and the subdivision control laws that were written were brought to town meeting, voted upon by the people of Deerfield as well. So in the society that we live in, that has been the place where people are able to voice their opinion and make sure that they're electing the people they want to have support them in this process. The other thing that has occurred that a lot of people don't understand or have knowledge of is that there was a plan put together quite a while ago called the Master Plan of how Deerfield saw itself progressing in the future, and we've used that as our template going forward to make sure that we're trying to do what the town of Deerfield wants the town to look like in the future. So I think if the public understands that, it might be helpful to those that don't do this for a living, for the process on a daily basis. I'll stop talking, let Tony take over the technical stuff.
And I will just add that once the presentation here, then we will take public comment, because that helps the planning board know what questions. We have a lot of questions we're going to ask. We go over the bylaws, we bring in peer review, but if someone in the public certainly has comments or suggestions, other things we should look at, we want to be open to that too. So.
Tony Wazewski, senior civil engineer with SVE Associates, 439 West Brattleboro, or West River Road in Brattleboro, Vermont. As you know, after our preliminary plan approval, we've been working diligently through to try to obtain other permits, and also preparing a definitive plan, which is a much more detailed set of drawings, constructible drawings for the subdivision road primarily is your jurisdiction. And so you'll see by the plan set, I think it went from maybe 7 sheets to like 27 sheets. So I could go through that with you, but I imagine that'll be the peer reviewers doing to go through that. If you do have questions regarding individual detailed information outlined in those plans, I'd be happy to answer those questions. But I think tonight what I want to do is, say that we're here for subdivision, definitive subdivision approval, and also through the board, we need a stormwater permit. Those are the two actions that we're asking for. Since our preliminary plan, we did do the definitive plan. We also went through the NEPA, Massachusetts, in the Environmental Policy Act by filing an ENF, which is an environmental notification form. The board has a copy of that form, and on December 9th, we received our MEPA certificate. I've given Pat 6 copies of that, that says that no further action is required. We do not need to do an EIR for this project. Also, this week we'll be submitting the Mass DOT. As mentioned to you in the preliminary plan, we do need to obtain access permits, not only for the 2 road intersections on Sugarloaf Street, but also for the utility connections. We have water and sewer in the street, and we'll be connecting to those to serve the project along with overhead dry utilities that will be running underground through the project. As you know, we've gone through the Conservation Commission. This project received a negative determination, so there's no Conservation Commission action associated with this project. We've also filed with the National Heritage Endangered Species Program. Received the notification back when we're doing the preliminary plan. There are some endangered species. There are a limited poly line from the Mass Bay layers that runs through a portion of the property, about 5 acres. We went and notified them of our intentions, sent them some preliminary plans, and based on the species of a plant animal, they will not be impacted by this subdivision, and therefore they issued that this project would not result in a takeover of species. We also mentioned that the preliminary plan...
Tony, could you just mention what they were, because I'm curious.
You know, it's probably best if you want me to say all of them. I mean, there's a number of them. It's outlined in your MEPA certificate that I gave you. There's also letters that were supplied from the state. I mean, I can read them if you really want right now.
It'll be a question. But...
They're all animals and plants that live on sheer cliffs.
Yeah.
Right. So mostly birds are...
Well, there was one bird and one moth. 3 plants. One was a snowberry plant, because we're going to make one street after it. And one was a shrub, and there's another one, I can't remember. But they're all plants that sit on the cliff. So a lot of times these NHGSP lines are arbitrary. They're close, but they're not exact, and that's what this was. So this is not an area where they live, eat, or breed.
I can read them really quick, but I'll do my best. I'm not going to read the scientific name because I'll really butcher those. But the Chow sandwort, listed as threatened, the round-leaf shadbush, a species of special concern, snowberry, listed as endangered, orange swallow, rosado moth, and species of special concern, peregrine falcon. And big ones, it's none of those. Species are going to be impacted by this, and therefore issued a no-take letter. So I'm probably butchering this, but as you know, the previous submittals, this subdivision property is a compilation of 5 lots, and they equate to about 23 acres in property. It's a little less than 23. The property is located in the Central Village Residential District, and therefore lot sizes for 2-family homes. 15,000 square feet, the frontage required is 125 feet. We have front setbacks of 30 feet, and we have side and rear setbacks of 10. The subdivision that we've designed meets those criteria. The other important thing that I wanted to point out is in the Central Village Residential District, there are a lot of maximum lot coverage of 75%, which is impervious area, buildings, sidewalks, all of those things, patios. And based on where we're at, we're less than 50% of that with the design of this. It just works out that way based on, we can put bigger buildings on here, but, a lot of forces play into this marketing, what you can, you can do. So just to let you know, at this point in the process, we're less than 50% of the required maximum. So it meets all of the subdivision requirements as far as zoning. I will tell you that one of the changes that we made, in the preliminary plan, we had 36 residential lots, new lots. We had 72 units. You'll also remember, and this was brought up at the meeting, along the easterly edge, we did have a retaining wall. And that's just the way that it laid out in our preliminary design. The goal was to get rid of that. It made no sense to do that. It's an open piece of property, and that we weren't constrained enough to do that. So that was eliminated, and the Loop Road was pushed slightly to the west. But in doing that, we lost frontage, so we lost a lot. So that's why we have 35 lots now in 7 units. The erosion alignments are very similar to what we have in the preliminary plan, except for that change that I mentioned to you. We also have put names on the streets so that you could review those. The Loop Road is has to do a little bit with an endangered species. It's called Snowberry Circle on the plan. And the cross street is Greylock Lane, and it's the way we've identified on the plan. The streets are, as mentioned in the preliminary plan, they're minor streets. They're 50-foot right-of-ways with 24 feet of pavement. The right-of-ways expanded at the intersection per your zoning regulations or subdivision regulations. There will be new public water and sewer facilities within that streets, along with the low-grade dry utilities. There is gas in Sugarloaf Street, and we intend to form a subdivision for gas, natural gas. We strategically placed streetlights. Your peer review will look at all of these. There might be adjustments on that, but we placed streetlights strategically within the subdivision. Because we've also provided walks as a minor street, we need to provide walks on one side of the street. So internal to Snowberry Lane or Snowberry Circle, you have one sidewalk on the inside of the street, and on Greylock Lane, you have sidewalks on both. On the outside of Snowberry Circle, the reason why we don't have walks in that is we're trying to do some storm drainage design that is consistent with your dust management guidelines for stormwater. We have a side road swayed out, and we'll be providing driveway culverts there. So that's why we're doing all that. As you have the environmental notification form we prepared for the NEPA process, that was based on the preliminary hearing, so we have some more lots, and we've estimated 288 trips. When we get to the actual definitive, we've got 245 average daily trips estimated from ITT, IT manual. For this project. If you go back and look at the Mass DOT and their website, they have traffic counts, and they started counting many years ago, and last count that they had was in 2014. It might have been updated because the website can fall a little bit behind, but the last one that they actually took a week and counted was 2014, and they had 6,696 average daily trips, annual average daily trip. Back in 2008, there were 7,000 trips and along Sugarloaf Street, and that's how it fluctuates due to economic conditions, businesses moving in and out, there's a number of factors, but that was the high that I saw on that website. Now, they forecasted for 2015, but they didn't count, so I'm using the 2014. So if you take our trips and you take what was counted in 2014, we're not quite back to that 7,000, which was the max. So MassDOT will be handling jurisdiction on that, and we will follow the requirements and what they ask us to do. But I just wanted you to know, just a preliminary cursory view of traffic there, we're not going to be impacting any more than what I was feeling in 2003. So I just thought that was important for you to know.
How many trips again?
245 from ours. Because it's a senior housing development, the generation rates are less than if it was no restriction because of middle age. I mean, you've got more trips going to work, kids to school, those kinds of things. It might be in the average of 10 trips per day per dwelling unit. For senior housing, it's more in the order of 4 or so, 4.5. Oh, yeah, that's true. And I don't do too much because I'm not a traffic engineer, but I've been around plan development for a long time, learned a few things. But the traffic is different from senior housing. They're not going out at the same times as other people. Usually their trips are at different times throughout the day. So we don't see that there's going to be any real significant impact to Sugarloaf Street. But as you know, we'll be going through MassDOT and trying to get those permits. And we'll be sharing this information with them.
Excuse me, do you know on the traffic count, is that in each direction or is that a cumulative number?
It's cumulative number total for the day. So every time you leave or every time you come back, it's considered one trip. We still plan on making the trail connection up on the northeast to Mount Triple Preservation. There's a hiking and equestrian trail that runs along the power line there. Through the NEPA process, when you file the environmental notification form, it goes out to multiple state agencies. And you'll see that we did get comments back, and DCR is positive about that. But we have to go through, so we'll be submitting to them and trying to get that trail connection, as long as we don't have to do a lot of added improvements. We want to just make sure it's a designated trail to get through the subdivision, not only by the residents here, because it's going to be public streets, but say someone at the corner of Mountain Road, if they wanted to walk through, walk the trail and come back down, because you can hit the trail at the end of Mountain Road also. It provides a little bit. So that's the intent of that. As you know, Triple Street is on the bus route, and there is an existing bus stops at Mountain Road and at Mount Triple Preservation, just in front of the parking lot. And we did send an email out. I am coordinating with them, but we want to let them know that this development potentially is going in, and see what type of thoughts they have, maybe providing an actual bus stop at one of the street locations, intersections that we have. During the preliminary plan, you know, we were looking at soils, but soil survey information that was on the site. In the meantime, one of the things that we did between preliminary and definitive is we went out and Mark had soil scientists do a number of test pits and evaluate the soils. We've also talked with the neighbor who is a professional soil scientist, who's actually a doctor, and understands that we went out and did some additional test pits, and we'll be getting a report. Dan was there for that work, and so we may have a little bit of adjustment in the stormwater management, but essentially the stormwater management is going to be what I explained to you during the preliminary planning process. I'm going to stand up and try to talk loud, because I think I need to point to you on this, just so that you know what we're talking about. We're talking about drainage. As you know, Sugarloaf Mountain does drain to the property. There's an existing berm here, and the majority of the water splits out in a number of different areas, here, 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 and here on Sugarloaf Street. Our goal was to keep the clean water and that water out along the edges. So we've created vegetated swales along the exterior. There is a concrete ditch here at the top of the slope. We have a slope here, so we want to intercept that water and bring it down here. The backs of the units and the street swales turn out and drain into an infiltration basin here, an infiltration basin here. That's exactly what we said during the preliminary. This is very low impact development design. Because we're asking the town to take these streets when we're done, in the internal part where we have the sidewalks, and that we will be firming the internal side of the roadway. In that area, we will be providing catch basins strategically, and then funneling that down and tying to dry wells. The community lot, which is, you know, could be a gazebo, could be something, is also going to mimic and be an infiltration center. All of this water, we have easements to the town, so they get in to look at these if they want to. But everything off-site the roads will be maintained by the condo association. Everything within the road, the catch basins, that which the town does typically, and we want to change that kind of design for them, is internal within the streets, and so it's nothing that they have not seen before. So, like I said, we grant easements to the town, although the condo association will contain those areas, those dry wells out, and it'll be taken to. It's no more than grass areas. We're trying to keep it low maintenance, but have it look all the same throughout the development. We do improvements, so our design is, one of the requirements of your stormwater permit is to improve the condition where we're discharging, or not to improve it, not increase the peak. And we do that. We've been supplied with calculations, your peer reviewer will do that. One of the problem areas that is investigated, and I think this was brought up by not only the town, but also neighbors, is there tends to be flooding here. Well, there's an existing pipe here, because this is burned, water gets out through here, and that pipe is more than half crushed, and it's a problem. We're gonna repair that, and then put a drop in, create that swale, clean it out, and make a new connection. We do have some catch basin, do some catch basins catching here, but the majority of this water gets treated on site. The one particular thing about this, this whole area of town is in the zone 2 water protection district for the water supply, South Deerfield Water Supply District, as well as over by their offices. So with that, because we're in that zone, we have to treat any of the runoff to 44% TSS removal before we discharge the infiltration basins. So we do that with the swales and four bays. And internal, because we've got the standard, more curb and gutter type of design, we'll have to run those water soil and water separators before we tie up the infiltration. So that's how we meet our requirements, not only for the town regulations, but also the state. So that's kind of just a brief, quick overview of the storm drainage design and how we handle that. We also provide access to those infiltration areas, so we're not building stuff, and so yeah, when you come to clean it out, you can't get to it. So we have 3 access areas to each of the infiltration basins. There's also easements to the town over those, so if they want to drive in to inspect, they have access to them. As I said, it improves. One of the things I do want to talk, it's important to know which waivers we're asking for. The waivers that we're asking for are the same waivers that we asked for in the preliminary plan. Intersection spacing, section 4222, section 4340, the structures, which are the catch basins. You have a standard rule of thumb that catch basins should be placed every 300 feet. We show calculations that that's not required in here. We've strategically placed those at the appropriate intersections and brought those to the infiltration basin in the community park area. And the third one, which we did not know at the preliminary on, because we are not really focusing on the definitive plan, section 4562 requires that each lot have concrete bound at the corners, because this is a condo project that really seems like overkill to us. When we request a waiver, we will monument each of the lots, but we'd like to do it with an iron pin or a rebar, capped rebar or something. Because we're asking the town to take the streets, we will be providing concrete bounds at all the appropriate locations, tangents, pointed curves, all of those that are required. I believe it's under 4561. So the preliminary, as with the preliminary plan and the definitive plan, just following off of that, reviewing the downtown Deerfield complete streets and livability plan, we're just outside of that scope of that work. But the things that we're trying to do with this plan are very consistent with that plan. There's a potential increase for public transit right on the bus route. There's a potential increase for bicycle pedestrian reuse. We're bringing in sidewalks into development. There's sidewalks along. It connects to the sidewalk plan that gets you downtown. Plus, we have the hiking trail, promoting that. Passive recreation. The new development is on public water and sewer, so the infrastructure is there to support the development. There's a huge expense to bring all of those utilities into the property to be able to develop, but it's there. We don't have to go tremendous distances to do that. The project, as we see, uses low-impact development where we can, where we think it's beneficial to the town and where it's beneficial to the project, where it can be easily maintained by the condo association and in the street where the town highway department, how they typically do their stuff, this will not be foreign to them. They'll know how to handle it. Provides housing for an aging population, and it's pretty close to downtown. And then in the housing production plan, there's a recommendation to provide more two-family housing, and this does that. So in conclusion, we just hope that you agree with our assessment that this is a good use for this property, and that it is something that the town has paid money, spent money on planning for, and we're trying to be consistent with those plans. Thank you very much.
I just wanted to add, that we're also trying to do a couple of things that are inside the master plan. That is to increase the tax base in town, increase the tax rate in town. So These are assessed in the $280,000 range or so, which is where I think they'll probably come in. And we're looking at somewhere around $320,000 extra to the town every year in taxes. With, there's of course a road to maintain, but it's minimal compared to what a standard house with children going to school would cost the town. We're also creating infilling, which is something that was really big in the master plan, to stop rural sprawl. And the hope is that people who are living out in the rural areas at this time, the seniors that are sort of ostracized, they have no way to get places. A lot of them have paid for their own homes, they don't have mortgages anymore, but they can't get a mortgage on a house to do repairs. This allows them somewhere to go and be able to purchase a home inside the center of town. Additional people downtown per the master plan. The intent was to infill downtown, to be able to increase shopping downtown, keep the stores vibrant. And we think that's going to occur as well. I've actually been approached by a couple of restaurateurs who are talking about Deerfield Center because they see an additional 70 to 140 people coming to downtown, which would be of interest to them. So we really tried hard to look at that master plan and follow that as our template.
Thank you very much. Yeah, just going through some of the paperwork, and it looks like you filed the application and submitted to the town clerk, received December 16th. And the fees were paid, and copies and everything like that seem to be in order. So that's the thing that we'll also be checking on, but it looks good so far. Board members have any questions at this time, or should we open it up?
Let's hear from the public first. And
so I'd like to open it up and see if anybody has any kind of clarifying questions or comments about this this plan that's before us tonight. Yes, ma'am, and if everybody, hopefully there's a sheet going around that you can sign in that you were here, and then as you make your question or comment, if you could just state your name, that would be helpful. And where can we move?
Sure. My name is Dr. Deborah Henson, and I'm a certified professional soil scientist, and I live at 20 Mountain Road, and I butt the northern edge of the property. And I spoke at the October preliminary site plan meeting, raised some concerns that I had about potentially high groundwater on the site, and inconsistencies that had been mapped by the Natural Resource Conservation Service. And so I was very eager, as an abutter and as a scientist, to actually see the soils on the site. And I must say that Mr. Whiteman was kind enough to invite me to a meeting to meet with his soil evaluator, consultant, and review the report. However, I did find the report to be lacking a lot of basic soils information that's rather standard for putting together soil profile descriptions. And therefore, I was not comfortable with some of the groundwater determinations that were being made by the consultant because it was not backed up in a scientific way from the data that was presented. I believe that I raised enough concern to Mark and to his engineer, Tony, that a week later they, in fact, had backhoe out on the site to dig some additional test pits when Dan Ishii was invited out. I wasn't necessarily invited, but I happened to see them in the backyard. And so I put my boots on and trudged on out. And Mr. Whiteman allowed me to stay
and participate.
And I got down into the holes, and I know Mr. Nietzsche. And so we were having a collegial soils discussion. And I was relieved to find that there were clean soils. I say clean, I mean no evidence of a groundwater table within the excavation depth. In the center portion of the site where a lot of the infiltration is proposed to occur. There was one pit that, coincidentally or not, happened to be right next to my property line. Test pit, it's near what was test pit number 3 on the plans that have been submitted. And it's in the area of one of the proposed infiltration basins. I say basins because the intent, as I understand it, is not for it to actually pond water except in extreme storm events. such as the 100-year storm, for instance. I know you talked to me, there's some inches in there.
I mean, they're only drained to dry well, so there could be very low. I mean, a big storm, you will see pond in that will drain.
They're intended not to hold water so much, but to drain into dry wells that then infiltrate into the ground. However, in that location, the original soils consultant, who is not a certified professional soil scientist, but does hold the credentials of a state certified soil evaluator, had indicated a water table down around 94 inches, I believe, and that was the level at which the infiltration design was based. Out in the pit where we were looking on December the 23rd, I observed evidence of a seasonal high water table, which is evidenced by bright colored red rusty iron staining at a depth of between 60 and 70 inches. And I say that there's a range there because standing on the outside of the excavation holding a tape measure down, it's difficult to discern an exact horizontal alignment for that because the excavation was down 9 or 10 feet in that area. No one was standing in that portion of the pit. I think they were ready to grab me a few times as I was leaning over. And so I do believe that they're going to need to do some redesign of the elevations for the stormwater management area because there is, as I say, evidence within the soil profile showing that there's a seasonal high water table at around 5 feet, which would match up perfectly with where my sump pump is in my basement, about 275 feet to the north. And so I did not find that surprising. There's certainly other well data from the area that I can present that shows that that there was water. There was water in the pit, and it was down around 90 or so inches. But this is not the highest level of groundwater during the year. And we've also had some atypical hydrology. We've been in a drought in this state, and our water tables have not yet rebounded. And so I am very convinced that the water table is, in fact, seasonal high water table, mind you, at around 60 inches. And so I just want to know, as it goes out to peer review, that there is that understanding that there are some elevational changes that are going to need, some adjustments that are going to need to be made there. As a whole, I was very satisfied with the engineering that's being done, the intentions, the way the plan is being presented and proposed. I think that as a neighbor, as a citizen, that the project meets the guidelines within the master plan and conforms to a large degree with the existing zoning, with the exception of a few of the waivers that are being requested. I hope that it's going to be a credit to the neighborhood. And I just want to make sure that it's actually constructed with the best site information possible so that I and my neighbors don't end up with wet basements. And we don't end up with standing water and mosquitoes in our backyards. So.
Just to clarify, the plans don't account for the most current information at this point because that was done after. Jan's going to be getting me a report that shows the information that was done out there that Gavin's alluded to. And then it's going to be some adjustments up in that corner. But we just haven't done that yet. So. Just that you picked
thank
up on
you.
That.
Yes.
And hasn't been. Those are on the original soil profiles.
I'd like to clarify a couple of the points. And that's the first is that we do appreciate Deb coming out. It's another set of eyes, another professional. She is the top of her what she does for a living. I brought three soils evaluators out that second time. The reason for it was because Deb did bring some questions to mind. But the main reason was that the gentleman who did the first soils analysis is not healthy and is not going to make these meetings. So we needed somebody who could substantiate the data and discuss it at the meetings coming forward. So we brought up Charlie Kinnicky, who was the director of public health for the state of Massachusetts. He is the guy. Dan Eche, who I've trusted for years for wetlands analysis, and would, if I could afford them, have them do my stormwater management and seasonal high water tables as well. GZA is a great company, but expensive. and the Board of Health for the town of Deerfield, which Kalaszewski was there also. So we wanted to make sure we had multiple eyes on it. We have a little bit of a discourse on actual seasonal high water table in that area. Not that Deb is questioning the area because her house is behind it, but because she's being conservative as she would be in the position she holds. And there are different ways, different techniques that are used when people are checking on seasonal high water tables compared to septic, how it's going to work for septic. Dan could explain a little more on how that works. I had to remind Charlie a couple times that we were actually doing seasonal high water table and not septic. We wanted to make sure we can have that conservative septic number, but actually where we think the water table is. And as we made clear to Deb, this is ultra important to me, obviously important to the neighbors. I'm looking to build 70 units and sell properties to 70 different people. I certainly don't have a problem with seasonal high groundwater or any other sort. We also want to make sure that we're building a project that's going to stand strong. It's not a one-year get-out sort of deal. It's going to take some time to get this sold. So people who move in the first year are going to talk positively or negative about the process and the project. If we do this correctly, then it helps sales in the future. If we don't do this correctly, it's dismal. So I appreciate Deb's time coming out. I think we all work pretty professionally together and we're able to come to some conclusions on most of the holes. The only one that we really have a question on is the one that was behind our house. And as we said, we're going to we have gone back to look at that again. We brought these soils people out and we're going to let Dan discuss a little bit what he saw as well.
Thank you. Dan Nitchie, GZA.
Thanks, Jeff. So is that, I don't need to go on long about this, everyone's been talking about the project, but the test pit we did here was the only one that we had high water table, what I call high water table compared to the rest. We were discovering those hychromas, those reddish colored soils that Deb was talking about, in around the 70 inch or so. That's where I'm going to be placing the water table. And that's based on a conservative methodology that Title V would use, septic. Mark just mentioned that there's a couple of ways you can look at it. You can dig a hole and you can look for just what you see for water. Obviously, that doesn't make a heck of a lot of sense every year, and even on years of drought years. But what we discovered actually is the holes dug in October, and we dug in the spring, actually had very similar water tables in the place we actually found water to what we found just recently. So those droughts should have an effect. I'm not necessarily seeing a direct effect on this particular property, visually looking in the soil for actual standing water, or what they would refer to as a parent water table. So this particular hole over here, all the other three were perfectly fine, very deep. We found some very wet sand at around 110, 115 inches or so, very deep in the property, in the soils. It really doesn't affect any of the development plans. That was probably the only one that we saw wet soil, but didn't actually find standing water in the bottom of the hole, but they were pretty darn wet. So I'm placing water table at around 110 inch in that location. But this was the one that was the highest water table. And based on Title V, I think it would come in around 70 inches. Standing water was at 90, physically at 90 inches at the Friday the 23rd that we were out there. These two pits that we dug here had very deep soils, no water table observed, deeper than the hole, essentially, wherever the heck that was. I mean, 118 inches is the deepest we dug. But those kinds of depths are not of a concern to this kind of development. It's the higher soil level. So that's my two cents right now. And then the written material basically reiterate the same things I'm talking about. They'll provide the soil logs, as Deb mentioned. That's more of a routine and proven way to do this with a short description.
Yeah. I have a question for Dan. Through your technical education training, you can tell that the seasonal high water table there was about 70 inches, correct?
Yes, based on something called redox features, right?
Exactly. Through that same investigation, can you tell me when that had happened?
Impossible.
So it could have been 20 years ago?
Yes.
It probably could have been 20,000 years ago when this was a lake.
There is potential, what would be referred to as a relic model, but those colors tend to be very muted, like a very soft sort of green, grayish color. These were fairly bright. Still could have been a while ago. I think my voice is bright, loud enough, I don't need this thing.
they're still fairly bright, what we're seeing there. And one of the concepts that Deb brought up at the walk, as well as to the board this evening, was there's potentially water could be moving horizontally through this property because it is layers of sand. It's not very clear layers like you would normally see at a riverbed, but there certainly is. It's waterborne material that has been brought in there many, many years ago. So water could be moving horizontally through some of the coarser sand layers, and they strip iron, and they get to another point where they're either coarser textured or some void where there's a larger amount of oxygen, and they will turn to rust. So the reduced iron turns to an oxygenated iron or oxidized iron, and therefore you can actually see it's more of a rust-colored material. That doesn't mean it's the water table. It means that there could be water moving there. So when Title V, is my understanding, my practice is in Title V, you go by the height of your high chroma models, models at the highest elevation. And in that particular hole, 70 inches is where roughly where we found that. Below that, there was a few more, not much, at a depth of like 78 inches or so. And then we actually saw standing water in the 90, 94 inch range. So there is some sort of, the phrase would be discontinuous modeling. So you get these bright reds higher up, and then you have nothing, and then you have standing water. Does that water come all the way up to where the red blotches are and drop down every season? I don't know. Unless you're standing there, it's hard to tell. But it doesn't seem like it's coming up frequently enough to reduce or change the colors of the soils around it. But there could be oxygenated water that's flowing horizontally through there.
So Tony, what is the elevation of the bottom of that leaching facility compared to the existing topography now?
Like I said, we designed it on the original test well, so we're going to make some modifications because we had it down around 90 inches or something like that. So the design...
90 inches below what's
existing. Yeah, so... Bottom of the basin is roughly at 95, and it drains positively to three dry wells that we have with a rim set at 94. So the 94, the 89, we're 4.5 feet down or something. We have a dry well that we're going to put in because we want to correct some positive. Mainly the dry wells there, for my intent, is in the springtime, so I can get some runoff, get it into the ground. A lot of times we do these basins, we don't do anything like that. We might just do a stone trench or something like that. And we will not compact this area back here so that we promote that drainage. We could leave a grass hole there and get the drainage into the ground. Having the dry wells in this area, there's no pipes connecting to it or anything. It's just giving the water that does drain along the surface a way to get down. When the dry wells fill up, it'll just come through the grate, it'll pond in those areas. If you have a pretty large storm, it'll dump through the spillway, get out towards the street, and then get into the drainage in Sherwood Street. But it has to go through a couple other dry wells in the connection to the catch basin of the street. So that's how this design is worked. Based on the design, it doesn't bother me. A couple, in the season, it might have, 6 or 8 inches in the bottom of the driveway, or something like that would go. But that's the design for this. Now, with that being raised to 70 inches, then I'm going to end up raising this area is essentially what's going to happen. So I have to redesign that to make that happen. That's all. That's what we're going to go with it when I get to the report.
We didn't go. The other opportunity was to dig several more holes to see if they came in at the 90 or 89 that we saw to begin with, but we, Tony wasn't there during that day. I sort of conferred, and the topography sort of tells us that really the water seems to flow about the same height through the property, so we have different topography of how it's changing. So as we have an area that's higher in the center of the property, we have 112 or 118 inches to depth, and where it's lower on the property, we're seeing water. Well, there was a question whether it was 90, and then you know, we're sort of acquiescing and saying we're going to go with 70. So we're trying to be as conservative as possible.
Thanks. So just maybe we can keep, if there are any other comments about, did you want to follow up, or Deb, you had your hand up, but then I think you satisfied?
I would add some other things to what Dan was saying as a description. If the pores are filled with water, you're not going to be receiving additional stormwater. It's not a perched condition. The idea is that the sands are highly transmissive. You got a head coming off the mountain in terms of a positive pressure, and so the water isn't sitting there stagnant, it's moving. But if there's water in the soil, it's not going to be able to accept more water in those same pore spaces. So just as long as they're taking that into account and redesigning that, we're good.
So I think anybody who's paid attention to the planning board in the last probably 20 years, water is a big issue, especially in South Deerfield, and that's why we came up with the stormwater bylaw a few years ago. And so this is something that we're going to look at over and over again, and part of our peer review will be very stringent, and we'd love any other input from people who understand all this. Are there any other questions about water? Because that's a whole separate thing. Let's stick to this topic while we're on it. Yes, sir.
Hi, I'm John Poreski. I was wondering who's going to maintain the swales? The condo association or the town?
Good question.
Right now, the condo association will maintain the swales. We're hoping that the town will maintain the catch basins and the pipes within the street.
Thank you. Why don't I have a follow-up? Because you mentioned that several times, that the hope is that the town takes over the roads. And I'm not clear on what that involves. And I don't know if anybody on the planning board knows that, or should it back to you?
I've done this before as a town meeting vote. We built the road to the specifications required by the town. Typically, the towns have somebody from the Department of Public Works that will go in and review the work as it's being done, make sure it's being done up to the specifications of the town. And when it's completed, then we file to have it put on the agenda for the town meeting and ask the town meeting to accept the road.
John, while you're talking about roads, can I bring some up? Yeah. So if you're going to have the town take over, this is a potential issue that I see. Sugarloaf traffic overflow parking for Sugarloaf.
For the mountain.
Would you not have a concern if it were town owned that the overflow parking from Sugarloaf could intrude on the residents there? Because once it's a town road, they have every right to park there.
Correct. We've had that conversation. We think that there's two things going on. We're probably far enough up the street that from Sugarloaf parking area that we probably won't see that happen, and we're not going to promote it. In other words, where the trailhead is, we're going to leave that as a trailhead only. We're not going to put parking spots in to try to get people in there and familiar with that spot. So if it happens, it happens, but we're not going to.
Well, I don't think you ever promote in Stillwater.
Yeah. Well, that's a good point. Yeah. But I think we're far enough away from the attraction.
I'm just throwing it out there. Once it's a town road, that's.
Yes. Yes. The people have the right to park in there, whatever the parking rules are in town.
And the roads are built so you could have on-street parking?
I don't know if the regulation is in town for parking on minor streets. I'm not sure what they are.
Those meet the subdivision regulations, so they're 24-foot wide paved road. So yes, you could park parallel and still get a car by to drive through.
And these are the kind of questions that we're going to put out to town officials, and the DPW will weigh in on it, and police safety, all the rest of it. So. Another comment?
Yes, the town is going to maintain the drainage ditches, and that's just to do with it. Who is going to pay the town employees to maintain it? The gentleman says that we're going to get all this tax money and no charges against it. Who's going to pay to have the town guys go in and take care of it? And after a few years, they're gone. The association petitions the town to plow the roads. They're not going to pay taxes on the property and condo fees for very long. As soon as they realize that they're double paying to have their sidewalk sanded, they're going to come to the town and they're going to ask us to plow in the same streets.
So I'd just like to clarify that, what order does this set? Whether the town accepts it is later on. Is it, or does that have an influence on whether it's done?
The way that I understood was the swales will be maintained by the condo association, and it is your intent to have the town take it over eventually.
No, let's start again on this. On the outside of Snowberry Circle, there is a drainage swale right on the road. We do put an easement along that so the town can get in there if they want. We grant them easement access. But this is a condominium project, and the homeowners' fees will take care of the swales, the landscaping, the infiltration basins, the community lots. The only area that we would be asking the town from a drainage standpoint to take care of would be the catch basins internal on the internal side of the road that drains to the community lot. Community lot will still be maintained. So if you look into the actual drawings, you'll see that we have catch basins here that would get piped down and they get brought in to the center, and we have some catch basins here that are brought down and piped in. So we'd only be asking the town to deal with the deep sump catch basins and the pipes within the road. The external area, all of the, you know, the infiltration basins and the swales along the loop road, those will all be maintained by the landscape contractor that is hired by the association to take care of it. Now that's Mark's responsibility to set that up, and we don't have those documents prepared at this time, but at a certain amount of time, that will get transferred over to the owners. They'll set their own board. It's like a regular
side. And what we're trying to do to clarify what I said earlier was that we're asking the town to take over the road because these are people buying lots on in a town where the it's a lot frontage and size of a lot as you would on any road in town, so that they can have mailboxes in front of their house. The snowplow will go through and maintain it. It'll be the same as anyone else in town that lives on a road, such as Sugarloaf Street and Mount Road and any other road in town. Now, that's the intent. So yeah, there is, as I stated earlier also, there is an expense to the town to maintain that. But the major expenses are, as it's been explained to me multiple times by many people in town hall, which they can't go on record and say it, is that there's an expense that is astronomical per child to put them into the school, which makes it a negative cash flow per house that is built in town. That's a problem. So this is a problem that we're not going to have here. We're going to have a child with something in the fashion which is going to allow us to have potential for positive cash flow toward the town instead of negative.
So thanks. One of the things that I think I'd like to ask for the next meeting and our peer review and other officials who we need to enlist in this, I'd like a layout of what is it that that the town is going to be asked for in the future and what comes first. You know, you build it and then a year or two later, the town goes to town meeting and what that. And also the whole question about homeowner association and the whole issue about 55 and over. What's the town's, like, is that something that we weigh in on? Is that a private thing? Can that change? So I think some of this needs to be clarified. This is a big project. We haven't had one in Deerfield. Other towns have had this, so I know we can find out that information. But these are things we need to lock down, obviously, before we, and then we also need to find, what is the planning board's, you know, what are we looking at? Is someone else look at those kind of issues?
I'll make a comment and let my attorney take it over. We're here to get approval for a subdivision road, A&R lots, and that's it. The town has no 55 and over bylaw. They have no condominium bylaw. We're doing the best we can to create this as we go through because there is nothing in the bylaws to be specific in that fashion. So, as I understand it, and Dan can clarify this, the limits of the planning board, I'm not telling you what you can't do, the limits of the planning board, as I understand them, is that you're approving or denying approval to a subdivision road with lots that have been shown to either meet the criteria for a A&R lot or they do not meet the criteria. We have two that don't meet the criteria, one on the street does not. And that's it. We're trying to be transparent by showing what we're going to do with those lots, trying to make it clear to the town that this, because of what we're doing with these lots, we think it's a positive enhancement to downtown. I don't think we have the same reception. These are all lots we're going to be open to the public to purchase on the just an open basis and do what they want with them.
But so the opportunity for families to buy this is still going to be, there's no way of deciding right now if there aren't going to be families with children moving into those houses.
That's correct. So the bottom line is
that needs to be kind of still an open-ended piece of it. What is
The bottom line is that is not what you're voting on.
Absolutely.
And that's what I wanted to make clear. So when we have the peer review look at the traffic numbers, we might not say that these numbers are based on a 55 and over. We might say these are based on anybody owning these lots.
Yeah, I'm asking you to make that determination. Do you think there's anything that needs to be done there? The Sugarloaf Street section is 2 12-foot lanes and 2 8-foot shoulders. The 8-foot shoulders are typically allow for sneak by traffic along the edge, and if something's parked there, and we know that that is an issue. One thing I will say, when you look at the plans and you look at the details, we do label public and we do label private on the storm drain, so it's very identifiable what our expectations are when we come back, hopefully after this is built and inspected, and the highway department and the water department has approved the construction of these facilities that will be taken over at town meeting. But it's very specific on the plan, what's public and what's private.
Yeah, I don't think there's a whole lot to add. I think Mark has kind of identified that we've tried to be transparent in this entire process and will continue to be so. But the 55 and over regulation probably will be the product of the condominium documents, which are premature at this point because those are still open discussions that are going on. The road taking, again, is kind of a separate process in the town. We've tried to spell out with a lot of clarity what we intend to do, even though we might not necessarily legally be obligated to do that, because this is a project that we've designed a lot on the front end, and we've tried to make sure that information is available for you. But our goal is to comply with the subdivision law in Deerfield as it stands.
And to let you folks know that I also have... to let you know that there are 10 units already reserved. People are reading the articles in the paper and calling just because of the articles in the paper. And no advertising, nothing has been done. And I'm reserving them as condo units in this project. So I'm going to clarify that we're going forward that direction.
No, we appreciate it, and you're being transparent. I just want you to know that we, as a board, look at, we have to look at, which is these could be used for other things, so that's all. So when we ask questions, it might be that we're going to ask questions whether it's senior housing or not.
Yes.
And over 55 and senior, maybe two different things too.
Right. But understand that we are in the process of putting them under reservation with obvious caveats on both sides of the process. Yeah. But to let you know, that's what we're selling.
No, that's great. I appreciate that. Any other questions? One right here, and then I'll go around.
Since it's the question, I have certainly a lot of concerns about this project, since it seems the scale of it's a bit inappropriate for the town. I think it all in one spot, even though it does conform to the maximum possible units that could be placed there, according to the current zoning. But the thing is that the drainage issue has been focusing on stormwater based on, I assume, the amount of water falling directly down on the site during the rain, which is a certain amount of water. The issue in the neighborhood, I think, has a lot more to do with the additive water coming off the side of the mountain, which adds to the amount of water flowing sideways through the sand layers that then, you know, fills it up so that the amount of, there's additional water there that's not, that needs to be calculated in, that's not just the square footage of the exact site. And that's a problem that's historically in that neighborhood. It's been proven before with the Crestview development area that whatever they did design for was inadequate, and people have had their basements flooded, even though they had, I suppose, some kind of engineer plan something. And in this case, I don't think they're necessarily addressing that well, especially because the investigations were done in the middle of a significant drought. And as much as they're looking at soil colors and trying to figure out what that means, it sounds like there's already some disagreement of exactly how you interpret that. And this was not a good year to do the analysis. And I think it would be prudent to wait and do an analysis maybe during a more normal year of precipitation, and make some conclusions on a drainage plan from there, also encountering or accepting the fact that a tremendous amount more water flows through that site than comes just down directly on top of the roofs.
Thank you, that's a good point, and that is certainly something that we look at in the stormwater plan. Was someone in the back there?
Yeah, Bill Waldron, I live on River Road.
Can you see our room?
In regards to the 300-foot spacing that you're asking for a variance against on the manholes, how far apart are the manholes that you're proposing?
We're not asking for a waiver on the manholes. As far as the sewer is 40 regulations. On the what we're asking for a waiver is on the stormwater catch basins. And what we've done is in our stormwater management plan, we'll see inlet calculations there, and we based the location, we actually placed the catch basins where we think they're most appropriate and analyzed those locations with the runoff that we have on the property. So based on that, they meet the criteria. We're not flooding the street, and so vehicle passage through the street is still fine. The capacity of the inlets are appropriate for where we have them, and that will be checked in peer review and I think found to be acceptable.
Is there a reason for the 300-foot spacing?
Well, yes, I can only surmise, but numerous agencies have that. They're thinking, this goes back to old-time drainage where everything was expected to be put in gutters and catch basins, and so if you do a calculation, it seems that the spread in the water and the catch basin, which are graded usually around here, it's appropriate to set them at that locations. So it's a rule of thumb, and in this case, I don't feel that it's appropriate to run additional piping up the road. It doesn't calc out to need those catch basins to start 300 feet from the high point in the road.
We'll get engineers to advise the town. Let me go, anybody else before I start repeating? Yes.
Elizabeth Sorensen, I live at 12 Mountain Road. And like maybe thousands of other people, I enjoy walking along the DCR trail. So I'd like to know first, why are the swales against the mountain edge concrete rather than vegetated?
She's asking why.
What the surface
is. Why are they concrete rather than vegetated swales?
Everything is a vegetated swale except for he'll show you.
Yeah.
Can you see? Yeah.
Against the mountain edge, the eastern edge.
Right. Oh, why that? That's swales. A concrete ditch there.
Right.
Why, it's easier to maintain. I want it to be. When we look at drainage, I'm going way to the top of the mountain, so we're calculating how much water we feel is coming down the mountain. It separates into two watersheds: one to the north, the bigger ones to the south. And what we're doing, because we have a cut slope there, it's not good engineering practice to let that water just run over that cut slope because you've got potential for erosion. I typically, when I design these, I like to put a concrete ditch at the top. It's easier to maintain. You have less possibilities for woody shrubs to get in and take over that swale, because I want to protect and bring the drainage around that cut slope. So that's why we have that. But down through the project, it's all vegetated. Once I get off of that cut slope, they're all vegetated swales from the back. So the back, you get the back half of the duplex, and you get the water from the lawns and that in the back drain on both edges. In the front, you get the front part of the house, the driveways, and a vegetated swale that runs through culverts under the driveways.
But that concrete swale comes nowhere near the path. It's not.
Oh, no, it's not near the
path or the walkway.
It's on our property.
Yes.
How does it connect, though, to what is currently a fairly wide tree buffer between the DCR trail and private property, which, as far as I could tell looking at the plans quickly, will no longer be there. One of the properties is within 10 feet of the DCR trail. So at any rate, what's your vegetated tree buffer between the trail and the property you're proposing?
This is 60 scale. So we're not touching anything off property. Within the state reservation, we are not touching. So that existing vegetation will hold up in this north corner here. This will remain treed up in here. These are concrete walks because they have to be by subdivision regulations. But this trail, which is, we hope to make our connection, will be designated with posts, reflectors. There'll be, we have right now, just split rail fence corners to identify them. We'll have some signage. That will be a DRG or a crushed stone walk. That will not.
Well, I may not have read the plan correctly, but it seemed to me along the eastern side where the trail is, the middle farthest east property you have looks to be 10 feet from the DCR trail.
Well,
I don't know if you share that with wider or an easement or not, but I would just like to know what the easement is and what the tree line.
This is approximate from aerial because we didn't go off property to survey that trail. It's there. It gets a little close at this one corner, but then branches off. This dashed line is roughly the trail. It's from an aerial photo.
Well, so, just a concern for the planning board and you all to think about whether there is going to be a tree buffer between the properties and the trail. Because if you're walking along the trail, you're just going to see a concrete swale below it at all the property. It's very different from what you see now.
Yeah. There is, this existing trees along the westerly side of the property will stay. We're not going on, we won't go on DCR property.
Why? Okay, thank you.
But you're right. It's going to get close there. And some of the trees that are there now will be chopped down.
Simple question.
Well, we didn't survey the trail specifically, so I can't tell you exactly, but it's probably in that area, based on that scale of 60 feet, it's probably 10 to 15 feet away. I'm not positive because we didn't survey the trail.
Right. It is only 10 feet away.
And then it branches off and gets further.
And
that's legit.
So at this point, I'd like to, we're going to be talking about this project for probably at least two or three more meetings, and the next time we're going to have, we'll have peer review and we'll have more specialists and we'll start getting into numbers. So I'd like to just maybe take another 3 minutes here to respond to people who especially haven't asked questions or had comments. Yes, ma'am.
I'm Penny Carson, I'm at 8 Mountain Road, and I have a couple of things. Number one, when I read in the paper or in discussion about senior housing, I think about old people. You know, I mean, I'm sympathetic. I think it's more important to call this 55 and over because it has a very different psychological effect in terms of sympathy. You're going to get more people supporting senior housing. So I want to say that. I don't think there's going to be any affordable housing in this group. I don't know. I also wanted to know, are there any plans for an expansion if you get the number of lots that you want? I'm very concerned about the second cut-in. I, along with other people, have asked for the DOT survey, which I think they would have done. But I want to remind you of a four-way stop in the village. And if there are 70 units, and this is 55 and over, it's highly likely there will be one, two, possibly even three cars for each unit. So we're talking about a lot of cars. We're talking about trash trucks. We're talking about mail trucks. We're talking about delivery trucks. We're talking, there's going to be a lot more traffic. And we're also going to have a Cumberland Farm, possibly, coming in just north of that. So there's going to be additional things. So those are some of my concerns. And in one of the articles, there was a question about using CPA funds, and that sort of dropped off the map. But I would just like to know, is there any request for CPA funds for this project?
Thank you. Good points. And as we sort of were, I thought, making clear, but we alluded to it, at least as far as the planning board is concerned, the name of this is the Condominiums at Sugarloaf. For us, it doesn't matter if it's senior or over 55, that's the developer can use whatever language they want. But when we review this, we just review it as 70 units, 35 lots, 70 units, and we have bylaws addressing that. The street variance, that will be DOT as well as public safety, police, and everybody will be reviewing that before that variance is certainly looked at. So I'd like to kind of move this along. As I said, we're not going to get all the answers tonight. I think most of the questions are on the table. We've heard a lot of comments, so we have another person over here.
Another question on the roadways, because I'm also very concerned about having two new roadways out into Sugarloaf Street, all the added traffic you talked about, and a very short distance between the two, and really about pedestrian safety. And I just would like to understand who, if these roads go in, then who, the town, DOT, the developer, would be the organization entity to go to about improving pedestrian safety across Sugarloaf Street, which is right now really not good at all. Things like, you know, pedestrian activated lights on crosswalks and that sort of thing. I did see on your plans that you had a crosswalk at that second intersection, which I was happy to see if that's going to go in, but who would do that? So, you know, to whom would one bring those concerns?
Well, that's definitely certainly certain over the town roads right now, but also the town is involved. So that's all why I say that it's DPW, it's police, fire, all these are going to get comments and have input into it. And I think like most developments, especially larger ones, there's the discussion about, you know, where does the crosswalk go? And that's where some of it is the town makes those decisions, and some of it will probably influence the developer as well.
Maybe these like four-way stops to slow down that traffic that just shoots down that roadway is a speedway.
Right, that
later,
so,
I'm sure.
So that I think is not the developer's issue, but more the town and the state for Chicago, certainly. Thanks.
John, I got a letter to submit.
That's what we love. We take letters. Sure.
This letter I received from Mr. Whiteman, and in it he threatens to maximize his profit to 400% and convert it to a 41B, a 40B low housing. I kind of take that as a threat to the town. That was sent to two or three different people that submitted stuff to the town. And if anybody else want a copy, you have that copy. And in it, he threatens to convert it, maximize profit, and convert it to 40B. We all know if it gets converted to 40B, low-income housing, everyone in these offices know the financial condition of this town is totally degraded. He's hanging that over everybody's head, and he has. And that's why it's hard to gain resistance, because people are so afraid of being low-income housing that they'll put anything else in there, they'll say yes to it.
Because I'd just like to comment very briefly, not getting into substance too much, but Mr. Whiteman has taken attack on this entire project that's been against my advice personally, and that he's tried to respond to every concern that's been raised to him in personal letters, in phone calls, meeting with individuals on the site to tell them his plan. And I've seen that letter. What's been described as a mischaracterization. He has outlined the potentials for any development site, and he's emphasized that that's not what he's doing. So the board can review, I hope each of you review that letter and reach your own conclusion about what was said in there. I just don't think it's fair in an open hearing to kind of summarize something that is not the way I read it at all. And again, to Mr. Whiteman's peril, he's decided to make some public comments and people interpret as they wish. But.
Yeah, again, I just remind everybody that we have bylaws in town, and that's what the planning board has been elected to uphold, and that's what we look at. Quickly, just a real brief comment
about the curb cuts. If the board limits the project to one curb cut, how much smaller is the potential project? How does that limit the number of units? If he is not given a variance because he does not currently own the property and it does have no real right to development yet.
So, I'd just like thank you for the comment, but at this point it's up to the, you know, it's a state highway, and so there's a lot of discussions going on, so that's a hypothetical.
If it was only for a curb cut, what does the zoning then turn this 70 unit proposal into?
It'd probably be a different proposal.
Well, but do you have an idea of how much smaller?
No, we have a proposal in front of us, and we have to work our way through. That's the thing. We get a peer review, we look through every step,
and
we look at everything.
The law would then require, if it was changed like that, as just a basic like numerical calculation?
It would depend on what the design was that they
chose.
The
street
from that
design,
point.
And
they
it's
could
just not
the
a random
thing.
Number.
It would have to be smaller.
Yeah, we'd have to. I'm sure the developers would go back and relook at that. So. Thank you. You just have to look at what's in front
that's
of us.
Not our
Yes, one more.
I wanted to comment on that spacing between the roadway intersections. You mentioned you're going to have the police comment on it and the highway department comment on it and all these, you know, different town departments, and maybe they'll all say, well, we don't see any problem with it. But the town's bylaw says that if you're going to grant a variance to that law, that it has to be in the public interest. So my question is, what is the public interest to have two cuts on Sugarloaf Street?
Or does it just maximize the problem?
I believe that's a state highway, and we can't dictate what goes on there.
And also,
why is Mr. Whiteman in MassDOT? Because that's the state road, Sugarloaf Street.
I guess I'd just like to quickly add, there are a couple places in bylaws that do talk about the interest of the town, and that is, I mean, there is no definitive, obviously, because as we know, many towns have, you know, half the people say one thing, half the other, have the interest. So it really becomes, you know, you elected the planning board, so the planning board will look at what we can look at, zoning board looks at what they do, CONCOM, police, you know, everybody does the best they can. So I think that's how we're going to move forward on this, and at that point, I'd like to kind of wrap this up. We're going to continue this public hearing. So I would encourage everyone that now that they've posted the notice and we're continuing it, we'll take a vote right now on when to continue it to, and new notices don't go out. So I encourage everybody to give input. If you want to write a letter, be at the next meeting, encourage other people to be here. We want as much participation as we can. That would really help us at the planning board.
As we go through this, John, we're also hoping to, we know that peer review is going to take 3 weeks to figure quantitatively.
Oh, this is a pretty good sized project. Yeah. The goal is to get it out because that's the critical path.
Right. And do you folks want to vote on that tonight or something?
We'll talk.
Okay. So the peer review, after the peer review is done, we've talked in ourselves, obviously we all have to compromise, we're living here, but we're willing to come more often if it's necessary. If you want to do meetings twice a month or something, that's... There's a lot of discussion, you know, so...
We might actually end up having a special stormwater meeting, because right. That is going to be the biggest problem.
There's 90 days, that's why I'm trying to
figure out
how to get all the questions answered in 90 days. And the other thing I just want to say, even though my attorney and engineer are nudging me, is that we are trying to follow the town master plan. Now that is going to inflict change to downtown and to the people that live near the project. There's no two ways about that. But if they'll take a moment and read the master plan, I didn't write it, you folks wrote it, select board wrote it, the town meeting approved it. We're trying to follow the master plan.
Thank you very much. Quickly, because I was trying to see you.
I was going to say, my name's Joanne Dickinson. And I have purchased one of those condos, and I am so excited about living there. And I am 58 years old, and so yes, there is going to be some young people there. We're not all going to be 80. I own my own home in Waitley right now, and I am excited about giving up mowing lawns and shoveling. And anyways, I'm hoping this does happen.
Thank you.
Okay.
So if I could just have the planning board discuss, so we need to make a decision about peer review. Sometimes the town has used time bond for these kind of projects, sometimes we've used Weston Sampson. I spoke to our building inspector last week. I think right now, Weston Sampson is helping with one or two projects. He'd say he's been happy with them. I spoke to Pat Smith, who was, and I'd like to also have her continue to be our kind of consultant on a lot of these issues, but she can't do it all, so we also want to put it out. It could be that we can have her actually write a kind of write some specs and send it out to two or three firms to get it for an estimate.
Particularly, in all fairness, you definitely should get quotes for the applicant. So,
because the applicant's going to pay for the peer review, so if we had some kind of specs on what it is that we need, we could put that out to at least these two firms and ask, you know, give them a real short time frame to get back to us.
and ask them what their timeframe for doing the review would be, because that's a critical question.
So is that something?
And who might do it? Because that is also a critical question. We've all had great experiences in both firms with
him. I just offered up the timeline because all the projects that I've processed through Deerfield, they've done the review.
Yes, we've had a great experience with them here.
And, but part of it is how, who they have available to put on this in the next, you know, 60 days too. So, Pat, is that something you feel like you can write up in the next couple of days, kind of what it is that we want? I mean, a lot of it is basically what you guys have presented.
And have the and have Tony look at it as well, so to make sure that we all agree that it's the appropriate specs for what that we want them to do.
Sounds good.
So we're talking about one firm, correct?
We would hire one, but we put it out, we'd ask two firms, can they do this in this time frame? All right, so let's, I don't know, both of that, but let's agree, we agreed to put that out there. And we'll get, we'll tell them we need a response 10 days. And then our, well, then our next.
Maybe a week or whatever. And you need to send them a link so that they could review the plans to develop their proposal.
You have a digital copy of that.
Right.
So you could just forward that.
Just forward that to them that way.
Well, then my next thing is that, and then part of this would be that they would have to appear here at the next meeting on February 6th. To start to give us some kind of report
I mean, the times that we worked before, there was a time at the time Brian Lady was here for the physical plan at Deerfield Academy. A lot of times, the best way to do it is, and we did that time also, is they get the plans, they do a review, and they'll send a comment letter, they'll copy. Either send it to Deb directly and copy me out, because there's going to be some back and forth.
Sure. And that has to happen between the engineers.
Yeah, between the engineers. But the goal is they're going to bring up some comments, I'll address those, and then we'll get to the point where we're together. If you want to have them come at that point, that would be great. The goal would be to do all of that by the next meeting, which is next month. It might be tough to do.
I also want to make no matter where they're at, I would like to have this on the next agenda and have the public, because that's when the public knows they can check in every 30 days and see where we're at. Even if we're not, even if there's still a lot of questions, that's fine.
Yeah.
But I would want them, present to and give some kind of.
Yeah. It takes time to go through the documents, and it takes time for me to address the comments, and hopefully we get to that point when I come back. I'm hoping next one, but if it goes to sometime, maybe we can have that scheduled stormwater meeting maybe 2 weeks after or something like that, where we could finalize it, then come back, finally, and be done.
All right.
Yeah, excuse me. I just wanted to ask, where in this process does the revision come? They've acknowledged that they have to change some drawings, and can they get that done within the 10 days of when they're hoping to actually send this package out to one of these firms?
If not, it would be done when they're
in process.
Yeah. Okay. There's a lot of revisions might happen during when we get to that point.
The goal would be to when they select the peer reviewer, just to have an updated design that we can send. So we're not wasting any time reviewing something that was designed previously.
Right.
So that's our goal.
Here we have a motion that we continue this public hearing until our meeting on February 6th, and between then we'll have hired a peer review firm based on the estimates, what we get after sending them the specs.
And that's under here.
Does it need to be voted?
Yeah.
It does. I'd like to make a motion that we continue this public hearing to February 6th, our next meeting, to review the peer review documents from whomever is selected.
I'll second the motion.
Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstained?
Mr. Chair, do you have copies of the hearing continuation request form?
That would
we
well.
Use, so I can, we can have them sign it.
Each time we need to do that?
Yes.
All right. Absolutely. This is, I think, standard thing. If we start to go beyond 90 days, then we need to make probably a more.
This is a way to avoid running up against that 90 days.
So, John, now that the public hearing is closed.
It's not closed, it's continued.
Continued, I'm sorry, continued.
Public comment tonight has been closed. Yes.
Can I say a couple of things? First of all, one of the biggest threats that we have in these small rural towns is urban sprawl. And so this is, to me, a necessity in rural towns.
And hopefully, you know, we've been hearing about senior housing, 55 and over housing for 20 plus years now, and nothing has happened. So I really hope that you do your best to, you know, stick to that. That would be great. And frankly, to utilize the water and sewer here in town, I don't think that's dense enough, but to prevent urban sprawl or help curb it. Because those are infiltration basins, do we run the risk of salt infiltrating into the aquifer, making it to the well? That's one question. Has anybody addressed that or thought of that?
It'd be pretty rare. It precipitates out in the sand, the sands that are down there, and it'd be strained out essentially. Because you would have to stay in a complete aqueous environment, liquid, all the time to be dissolved.
Yeah, because what I have witnessed in the river bottom land that we live in is the water does move horizontally, not necessarily vertically. So that would be a question. At each catch basin, do you have curb inlets figured in at each basin for with throated granite curb inlets? If not, would you just
I have a comment to Kevin to see what he wants of standard detail. We have that detail. Right now it's just berms with grates, but they're deep sunk catch basins and they're hooded. So that's how we get credit for that treatment.
Right, but in the fall time of the leaves, if nobody cleans the leaves off the basins without those strokes, they just don't.
Yeah. No, I'm in favor of curb inlets. No, I don't have a problem. I mean, that's an easy.
It's minimal dollars.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think that's pretty much all.
Yeah. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, if I could just add one more thing in regard to the peer review. I'm a planner. Yeah. So for my continuation of peer review, you had previously approved me to review the preliminary plan, so we need to go through that again for me to be able to continue to work on this plan.
Yep.
I have developed an estimate for you. I made a bunch of copies. I'll pass those down so you can look at it. We had talked earlier today, John, about the estimate, and when I look back at the, I reviewed the plans and the work that had already been done on it, so I actually reduced the estimate from what we had talked about to reflect the fact that I had already reviewed the preliminary plans, and these plans are significantly comparable to those. So I estimated $2,500 for that review. If it should, we'll review that, we'll keep close track of the hours, and we get to 75%, I'll let you know in the event that there's still more work we need to do. In the best case scenario, it won't take that much, and you guys will get some money back.
Okay, we have a motion to accept this estimate from the FERC. Again, if it's less than that, the money will return. If it's more, we'll come back and ask for it. Mark, the sooner you get that deposit in, the 2500
for Pat.
That way she can start her work and get the other paper in.
Yeah. And as soon as you let me know what the one is for the period.
Yeah. Thank you, Pat.
Is anybody new who hasn't signed in?
When you going to say something?
He's here.
So moving right along, our third public hearing. Let me read the announcement. Notice of public hearing. Notice is hereby given that the Deerfield Planning Board will hold a public hearing on January 3rd, 2017 at approximately 7 p.m. at the Deerfield Town Hall in Conway Street on the request of New England Patient Network for a site plan review pursuant to sections 5400 and 2230 of the Deerfield Zoning Bylaws. New England Patient Network proposes to rebuild an existing house on property at 4 Greenfield Road, Assessors Map 175, Parcel 8, for use as a medical marijuana dispensary. The site is currently commercially zoned, C3. Copies of the site plan and the site plan application are available for inspection at the Deerfield Town Hall during regular business hours. This was published in our newspaper, The Recorder, on the 20th of December and the 27th of December. And a butter to notify. Is there the applicant present?
Randy Eiser from Harold Eaton Associates.
for the applicant. John, so
let me just see what I have in the file here.
I don't. I gave 9 copies to somebody.
That's all.
So I have reduced versions that are all colored up that will help everybody understand what I'm doing.
I can have one of
those. Which version? This?
Everything.
Okay.
Assuming that they're going to ask me to do a review.
So the notice went in, notice was sent to abutters. So I just want to double check. The application was accepted by the town on December 27th. Our administrator put out the public notice because we wanted to make sure we could do that. But then upon further review, we weren't sure it was a complete application.
Right. How so?
That's, I thought you were going to answer that for me.
I'm assuming it was complete from everything that I understood.
Well, I guess that's so. So tonight we thought it was just a really an introduction to this. Then we're going to get further and decide if we need to get a review and how deep we need to get into this.
Well,
but I'm not clear whether it's a full complete plans yet, but thank you for distributing it, so if we could do an overview,
that'd
be great.
That's what I thought I was here for.
Yep.
As I understand it, I'm here for the planning board to discuss change of use. And the ultimate permit granting authority for this would be the select board.
We are not a
so...
No, we need the change of use.
Yeah, as I understand...
But that would also be a...
It's a site plan review for change of use. I don't know how in depth that needs to be. I'm assuming that it's an overview so you can understand what's happening there. And then ultimately, as I said, the select board makes the final decision. I was assuming that they would get all the nitty gritty.
We're the site plan review authority.
Okay.
As far as anything regarding the site plan, it's us. I don't know what you're referring to, why the select board is doing anything with the site plan.
They did a special permit for medical
marijuana. Oh, for medical marijuana, they would then,
for
the special permit.
Yeah. Okay. So again, I've never done one of these before.
Neither have
I. I didn't think so. I thought it might get interesting. So what I'm going to do is tell you what's being proposed and hope that what is being proposed is enough to satisfy you folks and that we don't need to go into an in-depth engineering study, et cetera, et cetera. Okay, so I'll go over what I've got and then we can decide how we're going to deal with this. Okay, thank you. So what I have is a property at 4 Greenfield Road, which is an existing residential building that is being proposed to be converted to a medical marijuana dispensary. The existing house is not big enough to house the dispensary as it's being proposed. So there's on the plan you'll see a proposed addition 600 square feet, that's orange. And then there's parking for 10 vehicles in the pink. That's TRG parking area. It's not going to be paved, so it's not going to be completely impervious. The yellow is a proposed chain link fence, 6 foot high, black in color. It goes completely around the property and also will cut the building off from the parking area for security purposes. And the blue that you see is proposed shrubbery.
So, let's see. The property is currently zoned industrial. It is in the medical marijuana overlay district. What we're proposing is an allowed use. Property is surrounded by commercial and industrial uses, so it's not like it's going to be a sore thumb in the middle of that kind of stuff. There's two sheds shown on the property. They're going to be removed. Parking spaces are 9 feet by 18 feet, which is standard size. The space between the parking spaces is big enough to allow vehicles to back out without hitting the cars that are on the other side of them. Also on the plan in red is a handicap accessible ramp, which will go from the parking lot to the building. There's some proposed lighting, but I'm told that I can't tell you about that. The police chief knows about it because it's something to do with security. I don't understand it, but that's what I'm told.
So you know about it, but you can't tell us about it?
I don't know where it is.
Oh.
I believe it's going to be on the building.
Okay.
Okay. There are 3 employees in the building at any given time. Hours of operation are from 10 a.m. to 7 p.m., 6 or 7 days a week. They haven't decided that yet. And they're predicting 4 to 6 car trips per hour. And that's it in a nutshell. I'd be happy to answer questions if I can.
What are the names behind New England Patient Network?
I do not know. All I know is New England Patient Network. And I don't, let me look and see if I have it on any of the, if they had it, they would have provided it to you on the application. And I don't know if it is on there.
So if I can just make a help, I think we didn't have enough plans to hand out to everybody, but just so people on and on the TV also know, we're looking down at the corner of the
There's one on the board as well.
Southern part of Deerfield there. And it looks like it's right on the border of Mount Sugarloaf Shop, our border. That's in Waitleyville, right?
Correct.
So this is the furthest property on Deerfield across from Yankee Candle. And right now it's a small
house.
Yes. Property in Deerfield. And this is right away. So there's a little bit of a right away there. Of course. All right. All right. The urban station is down here. All
right. Across from the gas station.
Yeah, across from the urban gas station. And the entrance to this would be where would the entrance to this property be?
On the south end. You just were pointing out the right of way. How can I? Let's see. I'm gonna pick out the driveway is there, and where is it?
So no new curb cut on.
No new curb cut being proposed. No.
And that's an easement that doesn't physically belong to.
Correct.
Now, how does that change going from a residential to a commercial entity with the right of way specifically?
I understand the question. I don't believe that it does. This is all in a commercial zone, so the right of way was not granted, as that I'm aware of, for residential use only. It was just a 30 foot wide right of way.
So that's a town right of way.
No, that's private.
It says here it's a 30 foot right of way in favor of Atkins. Who's Atkins?
That is the owner of number 4 Greenfield Road.
All right. So it says in.
So the owner of the right of way is.
Owns the property.
No, the owner of the right of way is.
The neighbor, Mount Sugarloaf condominiums?
Harris.
I'm pretty sure it's Harris Real Estate out back.
John, here's the bigger plan. It says that the right of way is in favor of Atkins, but it's owned by Harris Real Estate.
Okay, I got the little one and I don't need to use.
So, where's the front setback on this? What are you considering the front setback on this property?
Greenfield Road.
Yeah.
So that existing gravel is in that setback area. So it's 30 feet.
Yes. No.
The existing gravel is right, basically right up against the boundary line. But the right-of-way, the Route 5 and 10 right-of-way is quite wide. I don't know how wide it is in this area, but it's got to be 40 feet or almost 50 feet from the pavement to the boundary line. The pavement of the road itself to the boundary line is 40 or 50 feet. And if I'm confusing you, please let me know.
Well, I'm just explaining. Because the setback starts at your boundary line, doesn't it?
Correct.
Into the property.
Yes.
So I'm just curious how that that entrance to your parking area, what the spacing is between the fence and that.
So you're talking on the south side of the property where the parking is?
Actually, it's not the south side. It's isn't the
west side.
Isn't it the west side that the road goes up? The entrance comes in on the south side and comes up?
The west side. So you're talking about the existing gravel?
Right.
Okay, so and what is your question in regard
to that? The setback is there. In other words, are you going to make this existing gravel road be part of your setback? Is that the concept of this?
The existing gravel, it's there, so we're not planning on moving it.
But you're creating these parking spaces, or are they there already?
No, the gravel drive is, the parking spaces are not.
That could be wrong, but I thought if that's considered the front of the property, then that's your setback from there. I'm just curious how that fits into that.
Okay, so are you saying that the proposed parking should be X amount of feet from the front setback? Is that what you're saying?
Well, I'm thinking that's what it should be, but I could be wrong.
This is existing right there. The parking's over here, so the distance from here to here, this is part of the driveway.
Okay. All right, so you're saying it's what's there is existing even if it's being changed. Okay. All right.
Well, the way I'm looking at this is that we have a lot in the industrial area that's currently a non-conforming use. They want to change it to a conforming use.
That's a change of use either way.
Right. Yeah. The proposed addition is below the threshold to trigger site plan review.
No, the addition's 800 square feet. 600 square feet.
Yeah.
Yep. But site plan review applicability 5411 for municipal, institutional, commercial, industrial, or multifamily structure. One, a change of use, right, triggers site plan review. So it's not about the 600.
Irrespective of
the right. So it's a change of use. So irrespective of the square footage.
But all the so, right.
So all we want to clarify is that this required that this does require a site plan review.
And that's what we're doing, but what, you know, all right.
What about the stormwater?
Well, the feeling is that the parking being TRG.
Wait a minute, why do we have to get into stormwater?
He's asking if we do.
Oh.
Because there's a site plan review.
No. Well, wait a minute, this is no different than what just happened down there a couple years ago, so let's not even go there.
It's very different because there's already existing parking lots.
Wait a minute, you know where I'm going with this, guys.
Well, let me tell you that in site plan review, we talk about water issues. So even if it's not stormwater, we still look at all the water.
So you don't even say stormwater, just say water.
Okay, we look at them. And in South Deerfield, we know water is an issue, so we're going to look at it.
The existing drainage pattern is such that it all comes down onto Route 5. There's a big swale there. So we're not going to change the drain pattern at all. The parking is not blacktop, so it's not going to totally shed all the water. The amount of cars that are going to be on here is minimal, so the impact is going to be negligible, if anything.
Is it true that, from what I've heard, that the MMJ facilities get first dibs at recreational marijuana?
I don't know the answer to that.
It's going to depend on how the process proceeds in setting up the Cannabis Control Commission and when they are able to begin that licensing process, which has already now been extended 6 months. So that's something that we won't know.
Mm-hmm. And right now, 2018. Just going for medical marijuana, not the recreational. I would imagine that if that were the case, they would have to come back before the board and try to get a permit, either from you or the select board, for recreational sales versus medicinal sales, is my guess. I don't know the answer. And I'm speaking from common sense, and we're dealing with government and common sense. We know that that probably don't go hand in hand. But.
So I just, if I can just say that, so there is a, we have a medical marijuana overlay district, and we have some regulations in our bylaws about medical marijuana, and it does, as you mentioned, it does require a select board does the special permit. So they are going to be involved in that aspect. So right now, what the planning board is looking at is a site plan review for change of use.
Okay. Regardless, I understand that the select board's already made it very clear that they're proponents of MMJ facilities.
But just for procedural and timing issues, I'd like to suggest that this does need a site plan review. I would say we would like to have at least some quick peer review of the site plan to make sure that all the documents that they're submitting answer all of our bylaws for a site plan review, which is about water and traffic and lighting and things like that. And so we can't answer that tonight, but that can be, so I would suggest.
Perhaps a field visit by the our review agents.
Could I ask a question, please?
Yep.
You're looking at section 5411 regarding the it says for a municipal, institutional, commercial, industrial, or multifamily structure, which this building is none of those.
What do you say?
Commercial?
It's a residential use.
No,
right
what
now.
You're changing it to?
You're changing right. It though.
But it says four, so I'm assuming the four is what's there now.
You, either
disagree?
Either coming from or going to is the buying term.
That.
It's a change of use. That's it. Always means changing from the way you
change
it to.
It's being a change from a non-conforming use to a conforming use.
The changing from residential to commercial.
I guess one could argue if it's going to be commercial or not, but I concede to that.
Is it going to be
you
a non-profit?
You would consider that residential?
No, I wouldn't consider it residential. I would consider it more of an industrial type.
It gets to be very interesting if you look at what they tell you that the medicinal marijuana outlets can be classified as, and I think it's in the town's bylaw. They it's kind of out there in la la land, if you will. Medical marijuana treatment center shall not be construed as constituting an agricultural use, a retail sales use, a medical dental center use, a general industrial use, or any other principal use. So
it's a change of use from residential to a pot shop.
Yes. I don't understand what that section of the bylaw is referring to. It seems like it's its own entity.
That's precisely what that is to do, is to set it up as its own entity so that somebody couldn't go and say, well, it really is this and that's allowed here. It's like, it's a medical marijuana.
It's principal use, I thought.
And this is section 4650 of the bylaws.
But we didn't put it as a principal use then? As a special,
it's
as a line
item?
It's
an overlay district. Yeah. So they don't right. show on the use.
Right, the two overlay districts are over in that area and the industrial park.
4650.
The planned industrial. No.
Yeah. CID update. I'm sorry.
I know. Okay. You were supposed to fix that for me.
Yeah, you were supposed to. Mine is here to help. So the site plan review section is noted as 5400. Mm-hmm. So if the board determines that in fact that it's required, then the plans would need to be submitted to them in compliance with this section. I haven't had a chance to look at them. They may already be, but that would be what the board would be looking to determine.
Right, that's the part.
I'll review with you.
What is the sidewalk going to be made out of, the handicap sidewalk? Gravel?
No, it'd have to be.
John, could we hold off on these kind of detail until we figure out? I want to go with the procedure and whether, if we understand this is a site plan review, this is required.
No, but that would bring the threshold over 600 square feet, is my point.
The building is 600 square feet, I believe, not the. The threshold for 600 square feet is a building vision.
I think that this house has been there for a long time, this parking and all that stuff. It's not set up like that, but it's been there. They're putting a 600 square foot addition on there. It's not going to change what goes on there as far as any of the environmental, the rain, the water, the whole nine yards. I think that, you know, we have a tendency of making, you know, these things into these big projects. I mean, we're talking about a 600 square foot addition and rearranging the parking lot that's there.
That's
not the way it is.
There's no parking lot in there. They had a farm stand
on the side.
On the side.
There's a parking lot, but there's parking that goes along the front to the two-car garage.
Right.
And so what I'm saying is they're just manipulating it from one area over to another.
So I'd like to say, I believe this requires a site plan review. Now, the depth of the site plan review is up to us, and that you I think, immediately go to shoot blown up thing. I don't think that's okay.
Well,
but I think let's first of all agree that this is a change of use, and it's a site plan review required. And I don't think the applicant has a problem with that, because they've already submitted a lot of they've actually submitted an application.
Or a motion on that, John, or something?
Well, I don't know if you don't need it. I think they submitted a site plan review application, so I just want to make sure we're all okay with that. And then we go to the next step is, do we think we just want to do that here in 10 minutes, or do we want to have it professionally reviewed to make sure we're not missing anything? I prefer to have it professionally reviewed so we make sure we're not missing anything, not to add cost to the applicant. If everything's in order, I think in a few hours between us and Pat, we could figure this out, and we could come back at the next meeting or have a special meeting if we need to. But I don't see a hurry on this. I think it's important. It's the first step in, first medical marijuana dispensary in Deerfield. I think we shouldn't hurry through. We have time. Why not?
But just also be aware that Section 5450, we have the ability to waive the technical compliance when we feel that it's of a pretty simple nature.
Right.
And relatively simple development. I mean, how much more simple can it get?
I don't know. Because
it's 600 square feet.
We're talking fences and parking and sidewalks and additions, and I would rather have someone else look at it.
What do we do?
Change the direction.
What do we do as a planning board? Can't we think for ourselves? Can't we look at this? I mean, am I the only one here that says, I ain't got a clue, let's hire somebody?
No, I don't think.
Well, Kip, but you're also a select board member that in the select board has had a history of making it clear that they are proponents of bringing pot into town. So I can understand why you would be trying to push this.
No, that's not the case here, John. You know,
we're talking about site plan review.
Site plan review. What I'm saying is that everything here is dirt simple. I cannot see anything that any one of us can't look at and say, oh yeah.
I agree with Kip, myself too.
From this plan right here, you know that property, you walk the property, you know how wet it is, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera.
You know, I don't, John, but I've been here for 40-something years. I've bought tomatoes there. I've shopped next door. I used to plow the property next door. I mean, it's not a real big deal.
It is because we're bringing marijuana.
Well, that's another issue. You know, if that was the issue before us.
So are you going to vote against this as a select board member?
No.
We're not going.
That shouldn't even be a discussion here tonight.
Yeah.
And I'm sorry.
I don't think it is a discussion here tonight for overcome. I think what we have in front of us is a change of usage in a new endeavor. And I think because it is an overlay district, where it doesn't, they aren't selling tomatoes, and it is something that's going to be legislated differently, and we see the changes in the last 10 days. We see that there's a little slowdown. So I'm kind of with John in the sense that I don't think it's complicated, and I don't think it's going to take
hours and hours of time, but I also feel like, plop, here it is, and I don't want to push it through that fast. It's not gonna slow it down that much to look at it a little more closely, see what the implications are down the road. I don't think it's even gonna necessarily change a vote. It's just gonna help us to understand a little more thoroughly how this fits into our town plan. We just talked about town plan. This is a piece. We talked about this overlay district for a long time. We put a lot of thought into it, and now here it is.
And that's my point exactly. You did spend a lot of time, and you do have it, and here it is, to put it right where you wanted it to go.
Yeah.
So it's like, I use that word, that's where the town wanted to go. So here it is, you know, and what, even if you want to go to the whole nine yards, and you look at it, we're talking about a chain link fence, 600 square foot addition, and a TRG parking.
So the change of use goes straight to select board one way or the other. We don't really need to do this. We don't need to do that.
No, that's what the site plan review is
about. Right,
the certification for the dispensaries, that's their
thing. Right.
But as far as site plan review, which is the planning board,
right,
is about boundary information, existing building structures, including fences, loading areas, disposal areas, water provision, sanitary sewage, storm drainage, parking, walkways, driveways, landscaping, exterior lighting, compliance with all zoning bylaws, notification of abutters, signage, and paying the applicable fees. So it's 12 things, and I'm not.
And we don't.
I can't decide that tonight. Then pass all those 12 things.
Like, I'd want to hear what the police have to say. When we talked about the overlay district, one of the things that was a big issue. And again, I'm not really fighting this so hard as you may think. But
did you not get their comments from the police chief?
I haven't seen anything on this project.
Okay. I got something from him. I don't know. I don't quite understand what it says.
We have one, apparently, request for comments was sent out, which again, this is all, we just, this is the first time.
We're seeing it. That's part of it. It's like,
and so we did get, apparently.
They forgot to send a memo.
Well, no, December 27th, and the select board says the select board supports this project. It appears to be a low impact. I don't see one from the
police. So when we talked about, that was one of the things. Remember, I mean, that was one of our issues was, where was the fleet, where there was going to have to be some...
Well, the
police chief came and made comments.
Came to talk to us about it. So if I'm not hearing from the police chief now, then I think that's the thing.
Mm-hmm.
If the police chief comes to us, me, he's fine with it, he's fine with it. That's great. But I think that's something that we're remiss not to ask.
I have a letter from the police chief and from the building commissioner.
Here's some more. Let me just check the level. Highway superintendent says no issues. All right, here's the police chief. Request for comments. Wow. I got to tell you, I'm shocked. This went out December 27th. It got on our agenda, and yet we have responses for the request for comments, and yet we don't have it from things that take a month. But anyway,
it's odd, isn't it?
So the police chief was saying exterior lighting, including the building and parking lot. These are issues. Exterior and interior cameras, as previously agreed upon. Vault for overnight storage of products. Secure access delivery area. Security system with panic alarm. And I don't, you know,
and
so none
of
that's on the plans here.
Well, some of that stuff is, I don't know, that, I mean, the lighting I get, that'll pertain to this, but maybe the exterior camera, but the vault and this, you know, and the security system with panic alarm, that's all interior stuff.
Yeah.
I don't know how you guys can have jurisdiction over that.
And I'm also, though, usually we have an applicant here. I appreciate you coming. You're the engineer?
Surveyor.
So again, I kind of put you on the spot. But this isn't even your project, and to not even know who the applicants are is a little concerning to me, to tell you the truth. Whether we need to know that or not, I don't know, but I raise that as a
point.
I don't think that's ever happened.
Mm-hmm.
I've been on this for like 12 years. So.
Good.
So anyway, so those are my things. But anyway, I would like to have this... kind of look at quickly by a peer review.
And I agree with you, Mr. Chair.
Imagine that.
And who would be the peer review for this?
I would request that
so it's not in compliance review. not necessarily a full engineering review like we're talking about.
No, if you, if their plans show you that the impervious surface and everything looks fine, then we're not going to do it.
Just a check.
Yeah, it's really a lot of checks.
So we're talking a couple hours.
And that actually comes under your technical assistance thing, that we don't even need to give an estimate to the applicant.
This is true. You could make a decision that it's de minimis to the point where you're willing to just cover it under the contract rather than do it as a peer review.
So I'd like to make a motion that we do that. Actually, maybe prior to that, I mean, we do have folks from the public here, so I'd like to make sure we hear from them. So is there any comment from folks from the public? Yes, sir.
Hi. I'm Roger Lipton. I'm a lawyer in Northampton, and I represent Greenfield Road LLC. I also happen to be a member of the Whately Zoning Board, so I'm very sympathetic to you, members of the board, staying this late. I'll try to make my remarks brief. I think it is very incumbent upon you to determine who the applicant is, because as I read it, there's not even an entity who has applied. It's not an LLC, it's not an Inc. Even if it were one of those types of entities, you could certainly ask who the members are. This is some sort of a DBA. In court, that gets thrown out. You can't just apply if you're not an entity or an individual. You go to site plan review, are charged to determine who the applicant is. And that's a very fair question.
Thank you.
I have a couple of comments. Mr. Alice was asking questions about, well, where's your setback? So it looks to me like the entrance is on, it's not on 5 and 10 at all, but it's on 116. So it seems to me odd that the parking is right in the front setback area, and we have a picture which just makes it clear that there is no entrance on 5 and 10. So your entrance is off of 116.
That's the right of way they were talking about. It's not 116.
Okay,
it's so just the driveway.
So my apologies, but the point I was going to make is, so it goes past these other stores, which are full of regular shoppers, children, presumably.
Correct.
Is that an appropriate location for a marijuana dispensary? I have a handbook here.
Just to let you know, we already made a decision about the location. This is zone 4.
I think what he's referring to is there's a 500 foot rule that says you cannot have this within 500 feet of where children
are. I believe
it's
5,000.
No, this thing is 500. There's nothing that would qualify as a daycare or a school or anything like that.
So at least my familiarity with the town, looking at Google, there is a Mountain Brook Children's Center, and I don't know what the measurement is. You measure the distance between that center.
Do you
and
have an address for
them? It's a dead end road off of 116.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's not a road. What's that? It's not a road. There's a driveway off of 116.
That's 29 Sunderland Road, South Deerfield.
Thank you.
Yeah.
And that's more than 1,000 feet away.
Yeah. I mean, I just don't know it because it doesn't seem.
That's one thing that I would check under the review. Exactly.
Oh, it's just behind the cemetery. But, yeah.
Something else?
I heard Mr. Iser, maybe he misspoke. He said it was in the industrial zone, but the application says it's in the commercial zone, so just look for clarification on that.
The C3 district was changed. That used to be called Commercial 3, and it got changed to industrial, but there's still a lot of sort of anomalous references to C3. But that was industrial. It was always industrial. It just happened to used to be called Commercial 3, and that's why they changed the name to industrial a number of years ago down here.
Well, you're not supposed to say C3, so.
Right. It's the same thing. Okay. They didn't change the boundaries.
And this is an overlay district in our town, not, it hasn't been specifically zoned other than an overlay district.
Well, but it shows on the map. You have a map exactly where that overlay district is. It just doesn't show on the use table.
Right, on the use table.
Thank you. Any other?
Roger, are you representing somebody or just as a?
Mutual Road LLC.
What's that?
Greenfield Road LLC.
Oh, okay. That's what I was asking you. Okay.
Who are they?
They're the neighbors.
I think it's the old Deerfield Plastic building.
The butter to the north.
What about a pediatrician's office? Because I believe there's a pediatrician's office off of Old State Road by...
In the shop.
Yeah, on the backside of the shopping complex before Parker's Field. Would that qualify as...
I don't think that it qualifies as where they would congregate.
Yeah,
I understand.
That's an open legal question, unfortunately, the meaning of that term.
Do you know, so the Greenfield Road LLC, are they the butters or is Harris, who's Harris Real Estate, do you know? That shows on the...
Well, we're 10 Greenfield Road.
Going the other way.
So the north of this property says that there's a Harris Real Estate Holdings.
Sir, the butters and the butters.
Yeah.
Would that be... Then 10 Greenfield Road must come next.
South Deerfield.
Which I've never heard of Harris.
That would be Barker probably, Pioneer Steel.
Barker Steel.
Yeah.
Oh, so there is a different owner, I thought that was all the one property, but no.
No, that's the place they...
They're north of Harris, Roger? They north, your client north of Harris?
It's number 10.
So it's probably just north of Harris, yeah. Any other comments? Thank you. All right, let me move back this way.
Did everybody get the sign-up sheet tonight?
It is very simple, Kip, but I think we should look at this closely.
So let's actually...
Well, I think that one thing that Mr. Lipton brought up is should we be knowing who these people are that are actually doing it? I mean, this is not just your average site plan review, it's not your average whatever. Should we know who the people are that we're dealing with? That's the only question I would have.
Well, and on the site plan review, it's his name of applicant, and right now it has a name, but I think we need to look into, does that name have meaning? And that maybe gets a gray area, so we might...
I mean, except for that, I'd just say we just approve it. I really don't have a big deal about the site plan review. I don't have a big wish to do a site plan review. Let me finish. I'm saying that I think that it would be a good idea to see who's the person that's going to be doing this project here and put a face to it. I mean, I'd like to see the face to it. And I don't think that's going to hurt anything unless the guy has to hide. That's my only concern.
So what I was going to say was, Paul, your comment that you don't think we need to do a site plan review. We have to do a site plan review. It's how we do it is the question. So
I'm just stating my personal feeling I have another issue with it, and okay. that's the fact of seeing a face to somebody
right.
Who's going to be in charge of doing this, and has the police chief even met this person? I mean, because they're going to have head on head. Contact with this person or this company, and they need to know who they're dealing with. I just can't imagine if you couldn't know who the person is that is going to be owning this and being in charge of this.
So I'd like to make a motion that we continue this hearing until our February 6th meeting, and in the meantime, we ask the Pat from the Council of Governments to go through the site plan review checklist and ensure that all information is there, and if there's any questions, other questions or other information that we need, and that we get more or any other comments from other officials that we haven't received yet.
Second?
No, I'm okay.
So that's second in the discussion?
Yes. I'm just trying to see, do you think we have anything that says we should see this person or have them come to our meeting before we make our decision?
I guess part of it is what's legally we can require. If we can legally require that, then we can check that.
That's my question.
Yeah, so if we can check into that.
We'll check into that.
Do that.
It's certainly the case that by the time it got to the Board of Selectmen for the review for special permit, that they have to submit a lot of information that would be the proof that they're duly certified as a registered marijuana dispensary, and all so forth. So all the owner information would be included at that point in time, unquestionably.
They already did.
If I may, I believe that you're only allowed to deal with the site. You're not doing a owner review, just a site review.
We're just wondering if we can ask who the applicant is. If we can, but legally, if we can't legally, I say we won't, but if we can't legally.
I understand.
Well, I think because it's a change of use and a required site plan review, I would say the answer to that question is probably yes.
So motion and a second, any other discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed, abstained. 6-0.
7.
We abstained.
Oh, you abstained, okay.
So Pat, is that something in the next, I mean, by the next meeting, that's easy enough to...
Yes, sir, and you want to do it under the contract so we don't have to do the estimates or anything like that? Okay.
And what was the actual motion? Can I have that to write down?
Continue the hearing until February 6th.
Oh, just continue, okay.
And in the meantime, ask Pat to do the technical assistance grant so we'll get all the information is here and...
Is that aside from the motion or is that
part of
the motion?
No, that's just part of the motion. That's why we're continuing.
So it's going to be one motion for two purposes. One is to continue, and the other is to...
You guys are killing me lately.
Who made the motion and seconded it?
I made the motion.
I seconded it.
Thanks, Rena.
You're welcome. If I may offer you a little suggestion on your previous thing about the road, where the town accepts the road, typically what happens is they build the road, and then you give them a year or whatever.
Yeah, the winter's sure over before you have to leave.
And then you take it to town.
Good call.
Any other, mail.
Should I?
I'm looking at the mail. There's not much. Holiday mail. No, Christmas card.
All elected members must sign this report regardless of the year of your election.
It should happen, yeah.
So, sign away.
Be in touch as soon as you can.
Just look at it, read it, sign it?
Yep.
You spent no money.
You spent no money, so
it's
time.
All right, so
I thought I already did that.
I don't remember.
We do it every year.
Yeah, every year. Or somebody signs our name for us.
Finance.
Even if we're not,
these guys were elected.
Oh, I thought